It's 103.5 The Beat, Miami's new number one for hip-hop, R&B, and The Breakfast Club. Stitches is here for your pleasure. And, of course, continuing to recognize women in our community just doing amazing things. Hashtag she's doing it, honey, but you got to snap when you say that she's doing it. And today I have been... Go ahead and snap. Let me hit a snap, love. She came in with her African print fanny pack. Looking fabulous, representing her brands, oh so cute, and look about 12 years old, but she's not. Ladies and gentlemen, Danielle Duda! We're happy that you're here, and we just want to hear your story, sis. How you been?
I've been good.
So, go ahead.
It's a blessing. It's a lot of newness going on.
Yeah.
But I'm excited. I've been good.
And originally, you're from?
I'm from Philadelphia.
Born and raised.
Born and raised in Philly. Yep.
And tell us here, so everybody knows, what is your official title?
It depends on which hat I'm wearing that day, right?
Give me all of them, child. We got time.
I do so much, and I praise God that He continues to give me the capacity to do new things, and that He sees things in me that I didn't recognize in myself.
Wow.
But I serve as a commissioner for our governor. So I bring greetings from Pennsylvania, Governor Tom Wolf. He is our governor. And I've been serving on the commission with him for the past 5 years.
Wow.
He got elected a second term, and so I got back onto the commission and sitting on the African American Affairs Commission as one of the youngest commissioners in the state of Pennsylvania.
How old, man?
So I'm 31.
Yeah.
I got on the commission when I was about 25, wow. 26 years old. And this is a position that you cannot apply for,
mm-hmm.
and you cannot run for. You can't be elected. You have to be appointed by the governor to sit on his commission. So it's an honor.
Yeah.
I always say I'm not really sure what God is doing with me in politics, but we're here.
Yeah. That's everything is going through my mind because, true story, I had a friend of mine who was maybe at that time about that age that you first started, I think like 25 or something, and he ran for office and he was running against an incumbent, somebody who was there for like maybe 30 or so odd years. And
oh, wow.
He actually had a heart attack because of the amount of stress that he had to endure and just going through the process.
On the campaign trail, right.
So how... But your case, it's an appointed, so
it's
which
appointment,
means
yeah.
somebody saw something in you.
Right, exactly.
In Hugh.
Exactly.
Not you, Hugh.
So when I got the call from the governor's office, like, you know, this Harrisburg phone number, and they asked if I wanted to be a commissioner for Governor Wolf. And I said, well, what's a commissioner?
Right.
I didn't know what the appointment was. I had no idea that these were opportunities within our Commonwealth. And I said, oh, okay, well, if y'all think I'm good.
Come on,
all
now.
Right,
come
well,
on.
What do I got to do next, you know? And so they went through a very intense background check because they have to make sure that whoever they stand next to the governor is someone who is sane and who won't do anything that you know, will compromise our state, and, you know, just things like that. And so it was quite a process. Because
how long was that process and what did that look like?
That process was probably 6 to 8 months.
Yeah.
It took a while, maybe not 8 months, but maybe like anywhere from like 4 to 6 months, because what happened was they wanted to bring the commission on as one body together. And it's mm-hmm. about 25 commissioners throughout the state,
mm-hmm.
you know, and our state is big, just like Florida. But what happened was people kept getting red flagged. So they had to start the process over. And
what does
find
that mean?
New people.
Something popped up
in their background that was like, no, whoa. We can't have them next to the governor as a representative for our state. Because, you know, we don't just represent ourselves. We represent the governor and the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So we have the authority and ability to bring remarks on behalf of the governor, to speak on his behalf, and to be able to deliver information, you know, as surrogates. So it's a pretty big deal.
Yeah.
And once they found like a nice stable group of people.
Nice stable group of people.
You know, we were able to
which incumbents deal.
It was so special because they announced our commission during Black History Month.
Wow.
So it made it very special, and they had like a ceremony for us. So it's been quite an interesting process.
So I'm super interested. How did you get to that point to where somebody would recognize to call you. What was your process leading up to that?
So graduating from Spelman, I went to Spelman College.
Hey, HBCU.
HBCU love. And I actually majored in theater arts and dance with a concentration in African American studies.
Yeah.
So I am straight liberal arts. I'm a performer and a lover of all things black and history, as you can see.
Yeah, I can see
it. So politics for me, you know, it does tie into history and we had to study that often, but it was just a hobby. It wasn't something that I saw as a career option.
It was an interest.
It was just an interest, right? So graduating from college, I then went back home and began to intern. One of the places I did intern was at Radio One. And I got into media that way.
Nice.
But also on the flip side, I began to produce a radio show called My Philly Lawyer. It was like a legal talk show. It felt like I was in law school. It was like law with like a mixture of politics. And I was young at that time.
What made you want to do that? Go from the theater and the arts and now law.
So I know it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
But when I was in school, even high school and leading up as a young person, I was always involved in theater arts.
I like you.
I love you.
I do.
I love you, Stitches.
Let me pause. I've never stopped and said, like, I like you. Go ahead. Continue. Sorry.
So it's, you know, I can feel it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. But being in theater and someone who's a part of stage production, it's like you're creating an event within an event. So you produce the stage and all the art that's going on the stage, but then you also have to create an event to get butts in seats, to market, to create a whole moment out of it. So that, because one of our biggest fears as artists is that we perform to an audience and no one. Nobody got time for that. We rehearse for months on end. We're trying to get a sold out show.
Now you're going to see this show,
right? You know, so we rehearse for months for, you know, those 15 minutes on the stage. That's very important. So I began to learn the fundamentals of putting together a show. And I began to be on the other side behind the scenes, not only on the stage, but I learned the behind the scenes of how to produce. So that got me into the world of special events and promotion and sales and marketing. Wow. I took all of that to Spelman, did the same thing.
So this was before you graduated?
It's before I graduated.
So this was in high school?
Nice. Middle school and high school.
Nice.
Went to Spelman, did the same thing, auditioned for musical theater, auditioned. I was a band dancer. I was in the band, dropping like it was hot, doing it. And same thing, you have to get butts in seats. And so I continued to do those things that I loved. And at the same time, I then fell into party promotion because there was, you know, a bunch of party promotion companies on campus in Atlanta. Atlanta is just a mecca of all things fun
and collaboration
and turned up.
Right.
Okay. And so it was always a situation happening.
Right.
And I ended up being a part of those situations and promoting parties. And so that's what really took me to the radio station, because I knew that there was a promotions and marketing department. And I wanted to continue to brand myself as someone who did production, events, and marketing.
Grow. Yeah.
And from there, you know, I went to the radio station for something, you know, I mean, related to media, but not directly related. You know, most interns go to a radio station because they want to get on air. They want to be talent.
Yes.
Well, I wanted to be on the marketing and sales side and ended up picking up a whole nother skill set.
Which was
producing radio and learning how to be a talent on air as an intern. And that's what got me to My Philly Lawyer, the legal talk show, because they heard me on air with my mentor, the late, great E. Stephen Collins. And I was his student producer at the time. And he would throw me on air and kind of just put me into the fire. And I still have those sound checks, and they make me feel really happy because he's deceased now.
Right.
But he was the one who really got my start, took a chance on me and got me started in Philly. And that's how it all began. Then I got on air there, and then from it just kept going. Then I went to Comcast.
So when you were on Radio 1, was that a consistent thing? Did you end up getting a job?
I ended up getting a job.
They hired you?
Yep. I got hired as that producer.
Yep. And still, so producing and still doing on air.
No, I wasn't really on air. Okay. I was more so just the producer.
Okay.
Yeah.
I want to know this is important and I'm asking for a reason. What was your mindset coming into the internship?
Oh, I was walking away with some opportunity. I was walking away with a bag.
Okay.
I was going to out intern everybody around me because I was a college graduate and I was amongst students who were still in school.
Mm-hmm.
So my mindset was different from theirs. You know, I was still very humble in the fact that, like, okay, this is still an opportunity. Although I have a degree, I'm grateful to be here.
Right.
But y'all all gonna know who I am. And by the time this internship is over, I'm walking out of here with some sort of position.
Yeah.
Whether it's from this company or a company that I met through this company.
Right.
A bag is coming.
And
that was my mentality.
And how did that look? Like, what were you doing?
So I also had to hold down a part-time job, which I was working at the bank, so that I can actually make some money to put in my gas tank to drive to the internship because the radio station was out of the way.
Come on.
And so for me, that looked like I had to go in on the weekends because there was no show on the weekday that I could be a part of that wasn't already filled or could fit my work schedule.
Yeah, right.
And that's how I ended up on the Sunday shows. So my mentor, E. Steven, his show was on Sunday mornings, and the legal talk show was on Sunday mornings as well, but like early Sunday morning, like 7 a.m.
But you took it.
8 a.m. Sunday morning. It. Like, so that grind looked like me going in the house on Saturday, getting a good night's rest, not being out and about with my peers, but making sure that I got the rest that I needed to wake up
and be
to
ready
to take that drive to get on time to the station because you got to be there on time,
right?
To go on air.
Come on, sis. So you had your mindset was, I'm going to get it.
I got to get something. I have to get something with a degree from Spelman. It has to come into fruition. I'm not here for no, you know. And so a lot of the interns were very, what's the word? They were
lackadaisical.
Not lackadaisical, but when the celebrities came into they were starstruck when the celebrities came into the station. Everybody wanted to gather around and be hype about
working.
It.
What
and
you was, need. What was, you need. Talent, right. What do you need? Yeah.
I was on it. You know, I was on the other side. I wasn't in the studio. I was on the sales team. I was in the marketing department. I was making sure that I built relationships with the decision makers at the station. And that's why I stayed in the little conference rooms or whatever the offices. That's where I was.
Say that again. You were what? You were with who?
With the decision makers. Building relationships with the decision makers. I needed to be with the top two. The people who say yes and no to what happened at the station, they needed to know my name and know my work ethic.
Okay.
I don't even know why my mindset was that way at that age or what it was.
Because you were on go mode.
But something
you was on
at
go
21
mode.
Told on. Me that that's what I needed to do.
And the Lord had a position for you. Come
and
on,
that
somebody.
That was 10 years ago.
So we leave Radio 1. And then we go to Comcast, you mentioned.
Yep.
Okay, what happens at Comcast?
So I was at Comcast and also at Senator Vinton Hughes's office. And he's one of the biggest legislators in the state of Pennsylvania. He actually represents my district where I live in Philly. And so I was there working in the senator's office doing
How did we get there?
From the radio station, from E. Steven.
So they heard you and saw you. And
they saw me because I had to produce a show.
And you followed up.
Yep.
I presume. Okay.
Yep, I followed up.
That's the reason why I'm asking these questions, sis. Come on.
And they, you know, so I ended up being there doing an internship. And it was very low paying, you know, but it was an opportunity because he's a senator for the state of Pennsylvania. And not only the senator, he is the chairman of the Appropriations Committee, which means that he handles all of the budgets and he signs off on all of the budgets in Harrisburg. He's the money man.
Right.
So I also needed to get in with them. Right.
Yeah.
I was doing every odds and end thing, whatever they needed. Yeah. Answer the phones, make the copies.
That's all right.
Go set up the table. Like, it didn't matter to me what they asked me to do. I was just excited and happy to be there. And at the same time, I then also started to interview and go down to Comcast. And Comcast called me because of my mentor, E. Steven, because Sharon Powell Lee was looking for a student or a young person right out of school to work in government relations with her.
Mm.
And what I enjoyed about government relations is that it's like a mosh posh of everything. So you got public relations, you got media, you got event production, you got fundraising, you know, all of that in the government relations department. You got the, you know, the political side and everything. So, and that's the kind of person I am. I like to do a lot of different things.
Right.
And that was exciting for me to be there to do that.
Yeah.
Go into government relations. And that, again, was another like crash course to Philadelphia politics.
Mm.
Because what we did in that office was maintain and build the relationships on behalf of Comcast with the legislators.
Okay.
So those are the people that we communicated with on a daily basis. And I ended up producing a TV show called Comcast Newsmakers, which interviews local elected officials and leaders of nonprofits and like community leaders.
It sounds like everything connected.
It connected.
Properly. it was set and designed, and it just, you just walked in.
Yep.
You did your part.
Yep.
There you go. Okay. So now we have our show. We get from Comcast. How do we now become commissioner? They call you up.
So that was years later.
Oh.
It was like, it was.
There was a gap in between.
It was maybe, that was maybe 4 years later. But what I continue to do, so the great thing about mentors is if, you know, you build a great relationship with a mentor, a lot of times they'll introduce you to someone else who then becomes your mentor. So all of these people have
become. Chain reaction, domino effect. Yeah.
Mentors of mine. Mm-hmm. This mentor connect me to this other person who then connects to the, you know, and they become like my,
your
my
pool
village.
Of people.
Right. My wise
your
counsel.
Village. I like that.
And so I was working with Sharon Powell Lee in government relations at Comcast, mm-hmm. the cable lady, they called her.
Cable lady. Mm-hmm.
And
because you need TV because you're going to be doing your show.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And are you familiar with Comcast Essentials?
Yes. We actually have Comcast here. Well, not here, but.
So they have like this community platform where they provide internet for low income families.
Oh. Okay.
Called Comcast Essentials, and you can get like internet for like very low, like $9.99 a month or whatever.
Oh no, I'm not familiar with that.
So that program is awesome. I was a part of the pilot team that launched that program.
Is that only in Philly?
Nope, it's a national program now. It was local in Philly, but then we launched it and it became successful.
Nice.
And now it's a national program.
She's writing that down.
Yep. So
see what's going on.
So that was a great piece to put in my portfolio, but I ended up connecting with Councilwoman Blondell Reynolds Brown.
Mm-hmm.
And Councilwoman is really probably the person who then metamorphed me onto the major political scene in Philly. She became my mentor, and we have so many things in common because she's a dancer. Mm-hmm. So prior to her running for office, she danced professionally with Philadanko, the Philadelphia Dance Company with Joan Myers Brown.
Wow.
And the Councilwoman is very specific and keen on who she says she mentors.
Right.
You know, she's an honorary mentor for a lot of women in the city, a lot of girls, but it's not many people who she, you know,
calls out and says,
this one's mine. this is my friend.
Watch her.
I invest in her. You know,
him. Yeah.
So whenever she calls me, I show up. Whenever I call her, she shows up. And she has made history time and time again as when she first got into office, she was the only Black woman in city council in Philly at the time. And then she sat in council for about 20 something years,
wow.
creating legislation for women and girls and senior citizens. And she is just a huge staple in our community.
Yeah.
She's recently retired and has gone on to, you know, to continue her career, her next career. But she was really the one who put
what
me
is her
on.
Next? What is her next career? Just curious.
Author, children's books.
Oh, hey.
And speaker.
Nice.
She's just a, she,
powerhouse.
She sets the bar of woman of excellence like no other person.
Nice.
And I appreciate her because even when I needed to get my stuff together, she would pull me aside and say, listen, you need to get your stuff.
Yeah.
She'll call me on the phone and be like, listen,
tighten up,
girl,
tighten
I need
up.
You to let's get it, you know? And so you don't always have people like that in your life who will identify where you need to grow, but still love you anyway.
Nice.
And be honest with you. Right. And so she was the one who really put me on the scene. And then being on that scene, I started to work on a lot of political campaigns, getting people elected and just kind of staying within. Philly is a very big political town.
Yeah.
And sometimes business owners and people don't understand why their initiatives or things aren't getting off the ground. Like, you got to play politics. This is Philly. Like, it doesn't matter if you like politics or not. Politicians run this city. Mm. This is Philly. We're cousins to D.C. This is a major play when it comes to national politics and a local scene.
Right.
You got to play politics.
You got to understand it and know that it's happening. Know what's happening.
Yeah.
Actually.
And that's what I think just from doing that and continuing to work, whether it's on the legislative side. I don't do much on the legislative side because I haven't worked for elected officials, but I work on their campaigns and I work on their community initiatives.
Yeah.
And whenever people want to get the word out when it comes to millennials and women, they call me.
Mm.
And I just became that go-to millennial, young Black millennial in Philadelphia who is politically sound and conscious.
Right.
Because you know, politics is also an industry where you don't see enough Black women.
Yeah.
Whether it's in legislation, running for office, getting people elected, working on campaigns, whatever the capacity, it's just not enough of us.
Right.
So when you do become a voice for that, you are always identified for opportunities.
Yeah.
I don't know why people don't get it. I'm like, you gotta do, like, I mean, why not? It's open. It's an open field, people.
Yeah, yeah.
Just jump in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I want to ask you about this, because when we talk about politics, that was one of my majors, and understanding, like you said, it is, you know, it is a game and you got to understand that. But no positions and no parts.
Right.
Being a black woman, being a woman, being a black woman, being a young black woman, what were some of the difficulties, if you care to share, that you came across, and how did you actually get through it? Being candid.
I think that I have not run for office, but working with other candidates who are young and black, yeah, and then young black and female running for office,
yeah,
people don't donate to black women campaigns the same way that they donate to our male counterparts.
Okay.
So that is always a barrier, you know, and that is sometimes, I think, the fear of women getting into office, getting into
financially,
the game,
yeah,
because you got to raise the money in order to do it. And I mean, just, why, I mean, you can look at campaign reports and statistics, and it just shows that the numbers aren't there.
Right. And that's funny. Even with Kamala Harris, who was running, and that was one of the things she couldn't keep up financially.
Financially.
Yeah.
And that's always, that is a major factor.
Why do you think that is? Truthfully,
I mean,
you're just with your experience. Why do you think that is?
I think black women still get a bad rep when it comes to us being in leadership.
Okay.
With the negativity that's associated with being black and being opinionated.
When you have an opinion, you're too loud.
Being too loud, being strong. Are women emotionally sound to make decisions? Are women emotionally sound to make decisions? Is that a question to
so
be
that
asked?
Means you've heard that.
I've heard that.
Wow. Okay.
And I think that's one of the issues. And also because we need more black women and women, period, donating to women's campaigns, because a lot of the campaigns and the money that's raised is being raised by men. Caucasian men.
Yeah.
Who understand, because there's also a lot of businessmen who understand the opportunities in playing politics, and they do that.
Right.
And so we miss opportunities by not donating to our sisters, by not showing up in droves. Like, okay, yeah, put a post up. Okay, but I also need your $25 to hit that account at the same time, because that money drives the political engine here in our country. Unfortunately, yeah, it's just the way it goes, you know?
And that's something really to bring out, because I don't honestly think everybody really understands that, truthfully. So maybe that's a charge maybe for you, Chair, having that funds, having that just little count support somebody
support.
That you really believe in.
Yeah. So, I mean, I do. If there's a candidate, I mean, if there's a black woman or a young black person who comes to me and wants to run for office and I can support, like, I will put together a fundraiser for you. Like, I will do my part to make sure that you are supported, because I understand not having that support makes it difficult for us to get into office.
Right. Is there for you, because you've been in it since a long time, since you were less than 20. Is that even a word? Less than 20? You know what I'm trying to say.
Younger than 20.
Younger than 20, Chad. Is there a do and a do not that you will, that kind of is a flag for you that you won't ever get involved in? Does that make sense? Or is there
a political scene?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
do you have limits?
You do, especially if you want to go to D.C.
Yeah.
If you want to work on Capitol Hill, you want to go to the White House, you have to be associated with the party.
Right.
So unfortunately, if you're running as an independent, I can't help you on the record, because I want to go to D.C.
Right.
That is a goal of mine. For people who don't care to go to D.C., you can help whatever person or whatever party. But because we play by the party system in the U.S., you have to pick a party and stick with that party. So
right.
I vote Democrat. So most of the candidates, well, all of the candidates that I support are Democrats.
Right.
Right. I can't technically support any other candidate from a different party on the record, because, I mean, it's petty. It'll come up and people will try to be like, oh, no, they try to, you know, will like blacklist you or flag you.
Right.
If you are playing across party lines.
Yeah. But
so that's the do and the don't.
Has there ever been a situation, and you don't have to name, has there ever been a situation where just because it was the same party, but you really didn't, because you know how they say, just because they on your team don't mean they on your team.
Right.
Has there ever been a situation like that for you where it's kind of like you had to step back and it was just like, nah, I'm not going to do this one.
I mean.
And you don't have to name, just, you know,
yeah,
being honest.
I mean, morals and ethics are very important. And so a lot of the political work that I do, I allow that part of my body of work come to me, because if a candidate knows who I am and they understand my work and the value that I bring to the table, then they know how to find me.
Right.
I am not per se out there lobbying for candidates. Mm-hmm. That's my method.
I wish you would have saw her face when she said side face. No.
You know, that's my method.
Yeah.
You know, because I want those candidates who walk the walk and talk the talk. And so not candidates who just decide to jump into the race.
Because they know you have that pool.
Yeah. I want them to have already been walking this legacy and living this life. And then they have a body of work to point back to and say, hey, community, I've been doing this for X amount of times. This is the impact that I've created. I think this is important, which is why I want to elevate my platform, not getting into office and then creating a platform that you then have to memorize talking points for.
Mm, no. Not your thing.
No.
So there is a limit. No. You got to really believe it and you got to be for it.
Yes.
Okay. So now we get to the point where we've made it. We've been appointed. You get that call. And how do we get into women in media? Because you have your own foundation now. Mm-hmm. Okay. Talk to me about that.
So I was doing all of this at the same time.
Wow.
So Women in Media is 8 years old now. So mm-hmm. we got started back in 2012, 2013. Mm-hmm. So at that time, I was, you know, kind of working and interning. And so kind of doing them both at the same time.
Right.
And Women in Media has really become like our public facing platform. And that is the platform that people know my work for and they know me for. So I also have a PR agency as well, that where I do event production. I do public relations and branding. That company is AOI Events and PR. That company is 11 years old.
Wow.
But because Women in Media is such a timely message, it just so happened that God laid this on my heart at the time that he did, because it just went on fire and it just kind of just blew up itself. You
right.
know, Women in Media is a name and a company that stands on its own too, right?
Right.
I often talk about Women in Media like a living female, like a living woman. She literally walks, gets up, and goes wherever she wants. I'm chasing her. I'm like, okay,
where are you going?
You going to Miami?
Where?
I don't know nobody in Miami. Okay, Miami we go, you know?
Wow.
So she literally is a breathing engine, and it's just remarkable the places that Women in Media goes.
Yeah.
Because it resonates with so many people. So I saw a film about Philadelphia's art scene right out of college, and I was maybe home for college for about a year.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a documentary about our arts and culture. It only had one woman represented in the film for her art.
Wow.
I was offended as an artist, as a person with a degree who do this.
Art thespian, yes.
And as somebody who went to Spelman, like, I just came from an environment, a Mecca that celebrates Black women and literally provides what we need to be change agents and leaders in society.
Right.
Then I come home to my beloved city, and being misrepresented was not something that I was like really down for.
Wow.
And so I was excited to be there because it was a film that was put on by peers. Young people, excited filmmakers, and it was artists. It was a sea of artists, and everybody at the end was celebrating, congratulating, and they planned to shop this film and film festivals. And I'm like, but why would you do that? The story isn't finished. This is incomplete. You have one woman represented in a feature film for Philly. This is not. I mean, this is not an all male city. There's tons of artists who could be represented in this. And that struck something in me.
What was the response when you said that?
I didn't say it.
Oh.
I just started Women in Media. That was my response.
Nice. Nice. Wow. Nice.
I didn't say anything to nobody that night. You know,
you supported, you went through, but then
I observed. Yeah. And it just sat on me. Mm. And I, you know, began to just do my own research to see what was actually going on in the industry. And we were simmering up to the Me Too movement. Me Too hadn't launched yet.
Mm.
Me Too launched about 3 years after Women in Media had launched. But it's the same message. It's the same mission. Not so much the sexual
representation
and, you know, of women being misused sexually or whatever.
Yeah.
But the representation of women, that message is the same.
Yeah.
And that's what got me started with women in media. I began to do my own case studies. I began to sit down with women and document their stories. I started to have small gatherings called Bring Purple to the Table and ask women to bring their experiences to the table. I just wanted to hear off the record.
Yeah.
What are your experiences? What's happening? Started to do research, and it was all clear that, like, yo, it's some stuff going on.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter where. Women in Hollywood, women in film, women, you know, women in editorial, women in radio. Like, it was just a theme that was coming up again and again and again. And I began to study very closely the Women's Media Center because they do statistics for our industry. So every year they put out a report of what's happening as far as representation, equal pay wage, positioning,
right,
and where women are moving up in the industry of media and communications.
Yeah.
And I mean, we've made strides, but there's still ways to go, especially when it comes to ownership.
So, that's a lot, sis. So you're doing this at the same time that you're commissioner.
Right. Because, you know, Women in Media is a nonprofit. So it's a nonprofit.
Honest question, because I know somebody's, you know, thinking like, so how did you live? How did you make money?
So, I mean, through the political work that I do, I do that as a consulting under AOI Events and PR.
Nice.
And with AOI, we work with clientele. So as a full-time entrepreneur, I was representing clients and doing campaigns and doing events. And
still having your passion.
Yep, having my passion.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is awesome. So now we have women in radio. What are we doing now?
With women in media?
Women in media. I'm sorry. Women in media. Yeah.
So Wim decided that Miami was popping and then traveled on through. And I thought it was
Wim. That's Women in Media.
Yep.
Wim. So I know somebody here was like, who's Wim?
And it was interesting because we were not initially thinking about South Florida as a market for us.
Mm-hmm.
Miami was always the place we just went and turned up for spring break.
The party place.
I didn't think about it in the business sense. I don't know why. Just probably because we just associated with the beach and fun.
Just good times.
You know, and we were looking at a lot of the top media markets. But this opened up as an opportunity for us back in July.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it's only, what's this month? March?
March, yeah.
We've done a lot of development in this market in less than a year.
Wow.
You know, so I'm grateful to you, Stitches.
No, I'm glad TJ introduced me to you because she spoke very highly of you. And the moment we saw and heard you, it was like, oh, she got some.
Yeah.
And you had a essence about you that was genuine. That was very genuine. So what do we want to do that we're not doing?
For Wim?
Anything. What are we not doing that you want to do? Because it sounds like you're doing...
I know. We want to do so much.
And we didn't even talk about the wine that you work... sis, we ain't even got time, sis.
We don't. We're going to get that story in, too. So, don't worry about it. But women in media, I mean, there's so many places and so many things that we can do with women in media.
Yeah.
We have 4 programs right now, but we want to launch more programs.
Mm-hmm.
So we have our annual conference, which we are bringing to Miami for
nice.
The first time. Our 8th annual conference, we're going to have it in Miami-Dade County.
And what can people expect from that conference?
4 days of a conference and retreat the first weekend of November, November 5th through the 8th.
Nice.
Will be our 8th annual. So you can expect women from across the country coming in for this, but we also are excited about having the presence of women who locally live in South Florida taking ownership of the stage and really helping to lead the initiative. We want it to look so Miami. When Philly gets here, they got to be like, I'm in Miami. Like,
nice.
I can't have them be reminded of anything that has happened in the past. This has to be a brand new experience.
Nice.
And it has to embody everything that this city is about.
Right. And a fruitful one.
Right.
Nice. We work around here, too. We work around here.
So the speakers,
yeah,
you know, the honorees, and the opportunity to collaborate and network.
Yeah.
We want them to explore the city. We want them to see the beach. But mainly we want women to know that their voices are heard and that they are supported and empowered through a network of people, of women who advocate for them.
Yeah.
You know, so we want those women who are change agents, who are leaders, who are ready to really advocate for what we need to change this industry. You know, it is a meetup where you're going to be empowered, but we about getting business done.
And what are some 1 or 2 things that you can tell me that you see instantly that needs to change in the world of media?
I want to see more women in business who have media platforms, and so that we support them and that we spend our money with them. Nice. And that they are in position to be able to launch more companies, women-owned media companies. And that they, you know, that they have those platforms and those opportunities to do so.
Yeah.
But we also need more women who are working for major media companies who are decision makers, whether it's on the boards or in leadership, top leadership at the table, advocating for other women, not getting into those rooms and shrinking, but getting into those rooms and really owning your voice.
Nice.
And saying what we need as women. And if something is not happening or if something needs to be called out, to be okay with that. You know, I think in the past, you know, we've lived in times where people felt afraid to use their voice because of the backlash that they would get,
right,
or the fact that they would be, you know, maybe even fired. But that can't be a fear, especially right, not the women that we're trying to work
nice
with. You know, it nice has, you have to be able to do what's right.
Nice.
You know, so we want women who are agents, change agents and advocates who are unapologetically able to do what's right, not only for themselves to get an opportunity up for themselves, but the fact that others, like, we are representing a community of women. I mean, because I mean, even since the beginning of time, women have been storytellers.
Yeah. Tell your story. And this is what I'm glad you're here, because you're sharing your story and it's not somebody telling it for you. So where can people get more information about you and also the conference?
Make sure you check out our website. It's womeninmediaglobal.org. We have exciting programs that we're looking to launch, and we also are looking to work with people who could help us with our capital funding campaign, sponsors and partners and board members.
Nice.
So we are taking Women in Media to the next level. We're on Instagram at WIM, W-I-M, Global. We are on Facebook, same handle,
Instagram, WIM Global.
And we're on Twitter at WIM Speaks. You can follow me personally.
I was just going to ask that.
Yep. At DP Jeter. That's D as in Danielle, P as in Paige, Jeter, just like Derek. J-E-T-E-R. I'm DP Jeter on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and my email address is dpjeter@gmail.com.
Just Google her, child. Just Google her. And really quick, I want to touch on this because I had a chance to meet her, Miss Tanya. Who is she to you, and why is she important to you?
So Tanya,
Lord of mercy, yeah. Tanya.
Tanya Philip Yawley is my business partner. Mm-hmm. She is the founder and CEO of K-Marine Wines. And I'm so blessed to stand next to her as the COO of operations, getting everything elevated to the next level and really exposing our company and growing what we need as far as operations. So we are a woman-owned wine company. We make California wines.
Say it again. A woman what?
Woman-owned wine company. Mm-hmm. And we make California wines. So we have a couple of wines in our collection, and we are releasing a new collection this spring of 2020. We are based in West Palm Beach, where we have an art gallery, and we have a
And we will be
bar.
There soon.
We have Sugar Plum and the Grumbling Growler is our bar.
Nice.
So, we've been working together. We first got connected through Women in Media, because Women in Media is a magnet. Literally is a magnet. Yeah. It attracts what it needs. It goes after what it wants.
You know that you're doing the right, you what you're supposed to be doing, what God has you doing, when it's just like you're in it and it works.
Yeah. It's just like, okay, I'm like, okay. God, just send the assistant to check the emails or something. But that's how we connected, because Tanya is also extremely passionate about empowering women and wanting to see more women in ownership in business. So aside from being a serial entrepreneur, mother and wife in her own right, she uses her platform and her blessings to empower other women. And when she saw Women in Media, she came to us and said, I want to be a sponsor. Not only the sponsor, but I want to be the highest sponsor. What's the highest presenting sponsorship level? I'm going to take that.
Wow.
That blessed me so much, because it wasn't a corporation who came to me and said that. It was another sister who looks just like me.
Wow.
Who said, I'm going to invest in you. because
give me the highest one.
What she said? She was like, "Oh no, what, can I give more money? Of course you can give more money.
You can,
of course.
Why not Tanya?"
And that was that for me was awesome. That allowed us to go and get Yandy Smith,
nice,
to be our keynote. We've worked with Angela Yee. We've worked with so many awesome women, but it's through sponsors like Tanya,
nice,
in iHeart as well, who allows us to connect the dots and really open up the airwaves and open up the room for women to be connected. And so that's how we got connected. She would come down from Florida every year and be a part of our annual conference.
Wow. And tell us again one more time, where can we go for the delicious wines?
Check out KamoreneWines.com. That is KEMORENE wines with an S, because you need more than one bottle.
Come on.
KamoreneWines.
Drink responsibly, please.
KamoreneWines.com. Kimberly Wines on Instagram and also on Facebook.
Danielle, proud of you, sis. Just pray that God continues to guide you and just lead you into wherever you're supposed to be.
Yes.
And just keep going, sis. Keep going. Keep going. I don't know what else to say, but keep going. Anything else you want to leave with the beautiful people?
I just want to say thank you to you, Stitches, to TJ.
Yeah.
To the iHeart Miami family, like even South Florida in general. Like I came here with two friends,
yeah,
you know, three friends. And the fact that I was welcomed and embraced in such a way that was, I wasn't expecting that, you know. I come from a place where you gotta like prove your worthiness.
Hustle everywhere.
Philly, yeah, is a show me town. Oh, yeah, you say you do this, show me.
Yeah.
You know, in your own city. And I appreciate Philly for putting that battery in my back and for creating such a woman who works very hard, who grinds, but I keep my head down and I just do the work.
Nice.
And when I got here, just to see people to recognize that, to open doors for me and to say, no, we got you, sis. Like, wow. Like it's been great.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to be in a new place with a new opportunity. So I'm grateful and I look forward to connecting with more people in South Florida. I love Broward, Miami-Dade. I've been in West Palm Beach County, you know, and I've been staying in Broward County. And I'm like, I really like Broward County.
Come on, sis. Come on through. 954. We here.
So
we
it's been a blessing. It's exciting.
Well, congratulations to you for all that you are doing. God bless you, sis, and just keep shining. Yeah.
Amen.
Come on. You're lucky I ain't getting all your business yet. I'm going to save that for another time.
Okay. Well, let me know whenever you need me. I am a willing vessel and source, okay, partner, whatever you need. You could call us.
And I do want to ask you this really quick. What keeps you going? Because with everything that you do, like, we get exhausted.
We do.
And how do you decompress and what keeps you charged?
That's where that arts come in. We ain't talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
But being a performer, being a dancer, I'm a real dancer, y'all. I know I got to make that clear in Miami. You know, I ballet, nice. I jazz, I modern, I hip hop.
Nice.
You know, I do real dance, y'all.
Right.
But that having that artistic outlet, that place where you can go decompress and express and, you know, in dance when you're growing up, they tell you to leave it at the door.
Yeah.
And you have to train yourself to leave it at the door. So I show up in life that way. You know, I might be going into, you know, coming into the studio. You know, you don't know what's going on in people's personal lives.
Right.
But leave it at the door and show up and do what you're supposed to do.
Nice.
Right. And so having that has saved my life. Being young, I would say, I don't know where I would be without my art. I wouldn't be this person because it creates such a beautiful outlet for me.
Yeah.
But that really does keep me fueled and keeps me going. And I love to perform. I love to dance because that's when I feel so close to God. I know that is a gift that he has given me.
That's deep.
Right. And so that is my love letter. That is my love letter to God. That's my love letter to the world and to the audience, where I'm able to connect through motion and through music. And it allows you to express things that sometimes I can't verbally say. Right. So that for sure keeps me going amongst a lot of things. I come from a very stable and strong family environment where I'm supported and I'm celebrated, and they've always believed in all of the things that I have going on, and that they show up for me. I have a great friend
village.
Circle. But I have to work every day to renew my mind every single morning because, you know, they you know, the saying new levels, new devils, new challenges. Yeah. And I've experienced those new challenges. Being in a new place is exciting, but it's also a new challenge for me.
Yeah.
You know, so I have to wake up and remind myself of my greatness and renew my mind and stay focused on what it is that I'm supposed to be doing because I know I'm on assignment and I only want to do the things that God has for me. So wherever he leads me, wherever my feet go, whatever doors he opens, I know that it's because I'm supposed to be there because that's what I pray. To use my life for you and to take me where you want me to go and I'll just follow.
Nice. How do you know when it's not assigned?
When it's not for me?
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes you'll get like,
for you, because I know everybody's different, but how do you know for you when it's like, nah?
I mean, the door will just close.
Ladies and gentlemen, come on, somebody.
The door will just close.
Yeah.
The door will literally close itself, and you'd be like, okay, God.
All right, that's it. All right, we're done. Go.
You know, because I pray for that. I say, God, close the doors that are not for me.
Nice.
Just make it plain. Just close it.
Yeah, yeah.
Just make it plain.
And let me be ready. Let me be okay with it being close. Yes. Sometimes you ask for something now and you ain't ready for the answer.
You can't be. And my mom would say to me when growing up, she would say, Danielle, I don't know what I'm preparing you for, but I know where you're going to hear a lot of no's. And wow. You simply cannot wear your emotions on your sleeve. You have to be okay with taking no. Because I was a brat. I was spoiled. I was the youngest child of four boys, the only girl. So I'm used to getting my way. I'm cute. Why not? Give it to me. And they'd be like, no, Danielle. And I'd be like fighting for my way. No. And she's like, you got to get used to hearing no. You can't just force talk your way into everything. If it's no, be okay with no. And right. Don't wear your emotions or your sleeve. Keep it pushing. My mom be like, build a bridge and get over it.
Nice. So it's like you're taking the no. But know when the no is a no, and know when the no is like, wait a minute, it just ain't through you. Let me build that brick.
Right.
Come on.
Yeah.
Now that's all right, because I was going to ask you for the best piece of advice. It sounds like that there, right there. Danielle Jeter. Danielle P. Jeter. So bye. Follow on Instagram, Wim, right? Wim,
yep, you can follow Wim at Wim Global.
Camarine Wine. She chopped me up every time because I can't say it.
Camarine Wine.
I said it right.
Camarine
Wine. Camarine Wine.
Yep.
Camarine Wine.
And DP Jeter.
And DP Jeter. Follow this sister. Support what she's doing. Good people right here. God bless you, sis. Hashtag she's
doing it.